Well, hello. This is Space Gaucho. I wanted to do this video a long time ago, and I finally found the way in which I actually want to do it. And this is going to be a short tutorial on how to be kind of proficient with the F-14 A or B, but on the Rio seat. So buckle up, and we'll just go check out our bindings first, so we are on the same page here. All right. So we'll have to change the settings to our Rio. And the first settings that you want to actually set up are the HCU controls. So you want to have the HCU half action, full action, rear elevation up, down, left, right, rear azimuth scan wider and narrower, your bars increase and decrease, chaff single and flare single, the interrogate friend or foe. All right, so on the axis side, you'll just have to bind one thing, and that is the HCU controls. All right, let's continue. So let's do a quick familiarization here, and let's go talk about the components here and there. In the middle here, you've got the DDD. That's the raw radar display. You can control the distance that it displays here with this one, these buttons here. So you can actually see a small dot, actually a dash here, a small dash, which is a contact. But on this side, you'll have the most important part of the front panel, front upper part of the panel, which is the radar mode settings, so the weapons control system mode settings. You've got the IFF button over here, and you've got the different radar modes here. I'm gonna briefly introduce you to these later on, but we'll be using TWS manual for the most part here. So what you've got here is what people generally call the fishbowl, or the TID, tactical information display. You'll get more information. You'll be able to move your cursor around like this, using your half action. You press it down and then you move the joystick around. That's the HCU over there. And if you want to hook something like this waypoint over here, you just press full action. Let me just introduce you to the settings of the TID. Well, you've got the range over here. You've got the weapons control switch on and off and standby. So here you can actually change between the different modes that the TID shows information. Like attack mode is this mode here where there's a artificial horizon, and aircraft stab is basically the same. And then I'll show you later on the TID ground stab mode, which is pretty useful to know the real headings, targets are, or basically contacts here are actually flying. So on this other side, we've got this little panel here, which allows you to set different settings for your radar contacts, targets that you hook, or create waypoints and whatnot. Yeah, you've got your TAC, and over here you've got your very important liquid cooling for your AWG-9 weapons control system, radar, sorry, and the Phoenix missile. So they're both liquid cooled. And this is your radio here. And then you've got some important radar settings here that we already mapped, but it's good to know where they are so you can actually see what settings they are currently on. So you've got the bars here and the azimuth over here. Okay, so here we got all our jettison functions. All these here are jettison functions. So if you turn any of these up, it will arm the jettison for that station, and you'll just have to press right click on this one here and it will jettison. So the most important one obviously is to jettison the tanks once you basically drop to 14,300 pounds of fuel, I think it is. You can basically flick them up and jettison the fuel tanks, and you'll see the fuel tank quantity here. Fuel quantity, I mean. Well, this is very important. The RWR, you want it to be on. Then you've got the jammer here. You can set it to receive and then quickly to repeat in case of being attacked. You've got your data link over here. Data link, basically, you have to set it on over here and then set the correct frequency. I'll show you later how to do that. And this should always be in manual unless you know how to use the auto system for the countermeasures. This will allow you to drop countermeasures as intended. I think if you change these here to normal, it will allow the pilot to drop chaff. Please correct me on that. I'm not really sure. Pilot will make the pilot be able to only launch flares. Yeah, oxygen, don't forget that. This is the ejection seat handle, safety handle. And yeah, it's basically all the instruments you need to know. So, all right, let's continue the simulation and let's see if I can actually turn on the data link to see some targets. Alrighty, so I just pressed Shift K to open the kneeboard and I pressed the right bracket twice so that I could move to this page here where it shows the information on the data link. And the data link platform in this case is an E3A. So let's change the, oh, there we go, the range to 200 miles. And let's pause. So at this stage, we are seeing a couple of contacts, and this will be pretty, I'm going to be as straightforward as possible. So this guy over here, this is a bandit flying at range of 30. We are not being able to detect him because we don't have a full square on top of that, right? So if this part of the symbol is completed, that means that it is a data link contact. So the E3 is actually providing that. In this case, we've got a friendly. This is a hostile because it's kind of a rhomboid, let's say a diamond figure. And this circle one is a friendly. But what you see on top there is the symbology for a radar contact that is actually being detected by our own aircraft, like this guy over here. This guy's Angels 10 approximately, this guy's below Angels 10, and this guy is close to Angel 30. That's the basic information that you get without hooking a target. Let's just hook a target, let's see what happens. Well, we'll try hooking the friendly over there. All right, let's hook him. To allow us to move the TID cursor mode should be on this position, and then we do a half action press, and then we do a full action press on this guy. All right, we are on RWS. That means that we won't be able to do any of that. We won't be able to do any hooking. I just switched to TWS, and now, look at that. I can actually hook this guy. All right, as you noticed, in RWS mode, you can't hook targets on the TID. I really did not intend to do that, but it actually helps to demonstrate that the radar is not broke if you are trying to do that and it's not working. It's just that you are in a different radar mode. And in this case, what we are seeing is that we've got a range of 78 miles and, let's wait for it, 12,000 feet of altitude for this target. And the other thing that we should note is this indicator here. That's the closure rate indicator. So he's flying towards us 768 knots of closure. In reality, this information here, these vectors that you see here, are not really very trustworthy. And let me explain why. Let's just switch to ground stab mode. All right. Now in ground stab mode, the picture changes quite a bit. And first off, we see our AWACS over here, which is flying behind us. And what this actually shows is our aircraft in relation to the north, west, east, and south cardinal points. And basically it just shows true headings now. So this guy is really actually flying towards us. But this guy over here, though, he is not. He is actually, he's doing something that's actually called notching. So he's basically flying perpendicular to a radar beam. And this achieves one thing that's very important, that is he is hiding inside our Doppler filter. So basically any post-Doppler modes, like let's say TLS manual, RWS, post-Doppler search, or yeah, TLS order, and also post-Doppler STT, are susceptible to notching. Or radar beams are coming like this. And if this guy is flying perpendicular to us, he is flying at the same speed that the ground is moving towards us. So basically what happens is that this guy disappears in the ground filter that the pulse Doppler radar has. I'm not an expert. I should not be teaching you these things, but I want to give you the basic rationale about that. Let's just try to IFF this guy and really see if he's an actual friendly. So I'll pause, and as you can see, I've got this guy hooked. Let's do that again. I do a half press, half action, full action on that guy, and I press the IFF on, look at that, an equal sign. That means that's a friendly. All right. So let's try finding some bandits here, because this guy here is notching us, but we know that there's another guy. Yeah, there he is. And what I'm gonna do next is I'm gonna lower the elevation bar, scans, and close the azimuth a little bit. This will allow the radar antenna to move faster. All right, let's see. So this guy here is a hostile. Yeah, that's a symbol of a hostile, a single dash. Well, not necessarily a hostile, but a bogey. What this means is that maybe a friendly Mirage forgot to turn on its IFF, and you might think that it is a bandit, but you're shooting a friendly. So just be careful. Just because they don't return a IFF signal does not mean that they are a bandit. But most of the times, if you're pointing your aircraft into the right direction, that will be the case. So let's continue. And now that we know that this guy is a bandit, we just have to switch this wheel to target data and set him to hostile. And what you can also do is set him to mandatory attack and then turn on TWS auto. And now that we know that this guy over here is actually a friendly, we can set him to friendly and do not attack. What this will do is to actually set the TWS auto mode so that it will not actually track or keep the rhomboid centered on this guy. And this will actually help us, there we go. This will actually help us keep the antenna steered on the guy that we actually want to attack, that is this guy over here. All right, you see the symbology, this fully crossed out line, that's not do not attack, and the triangle shaped thingy here, crossed out on the middle, that means that the is actually set as mandatory attack. Why we don't see the full rhomboid here, or the full diamond figure here, that's because he's flying so low. Let's unpause here. Yeah, I did not hook that guy. That's pretty neat. Come on, let's hook him. Yeah, he's flying at 2,000 feet, and the AWACS, for some reason, cannot pick him up. So the AWACS is flying to this guy, but we are actually picking him up. And all right, he's closing at 790 knots. I'll just tell our pilot to increase the speed by 200 knots. Oh, that was a little bit loud. And this is what we always want to do. We want to actually get to a speed in which your missile will have an advantage. And as you can see, the closure rate is actually increasing. The best is always to get a closure rate of 1,000 knots. And the Phoenix are, depending on the model, you'll find a sweet spot for anyone, but 40 miles for the Mark 60s on slow moving targets are pretty good. And the other thing we want to do is remember to always press the next launch button after you hook a target. So you'll hook this guy, and then you press the next launch button, and then you press launch and Fox 3. And why I did that, it is basically so that we are pretty sure that we are going to actually launch on that guy. Because the TWS mode will assign a number. In this case, it's already set up to the countdown. And 17 seconds, I think. That blinking thing here is that the missile went pitbull, so it went active. Yep, he's dead. All right, so this other guy is still notching us. We can go back to pulse search and then to TLS and to verify that. So Angel 30, we are flying, Angel 20. Well, he's actually not notching us anymore, but look at this. We can actually go to pulse search. And we'll also do this. We'll increase the pulse video gain and everything. And then we're gonna switch to the radar mode here. And we're gonna actually try to find this guy. Okay, he's 50. 50 sounds a little bit better. Oh yeah, there we go. You can actually see that guy over there. It's a little dot over there. So you do half action, and now you've got a faster moving thingy over there. Yeah, there we go.
There's a friendly Hercules. 12 o'clock, 12 miles.
Yeah, we don't care about that guy, Jester. All right, now that we've got this guy over there, I'm gonna set up the... There we go, set that up over there. I'm gonna launch a missile in pulse STT mode. Remember, this is a pulse mode, so if that guy starts dropping, we might lose the track. Gestures, or basically the other AI is not in any moment. I think I covered everything. If you guys think I missed something that I should add something else, I will cover INS alignment, but there's a ton of videos out there that do that better than I do, and then I can do it. And yeah, well, there's a couple of other quirks and tips, but I'll just add them in the description so that you can actually practice them. So, well, I hope this was helpful, and yeah, let's drop the tanks. Ah, there they go. Tanks are gone. All right. Adios.